السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله.
الحمد لله، نحمده ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. وبعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى إن القرآن ساز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فبما رحمة من الله لنت لهم ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. فاعف عنهم واستغفر لهم وشاورهم في الأمر. الله سبحانه وتعالى speaks here about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and through him to all of us, addressing one very important aspect: how to unite people, how to change people. When you are in a society, when we are in a family, when we as individuals, we have issues. And you ask, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, and he came to the city of Medina with so many problems. Yet he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an agent for change. How did that happen? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks here about a general concept. When Allah says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Indeed, it is by special compassion and love of Allah, rahmah from Allah, that you were lenient, you were tender, you were gentle with them. Had you been harsh, rough-hearted, they indeed would have dispersed away from you. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding What happened in the Battle of Uhud? Those people that ran away and they left you and they did not hold the standard and disobeyed and caused what they caused. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells His beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, indeed, pardon them, forgive them, and continue to take their opinion. Within this verse, the concept I want to share with you today is the following. First, it is a sign that we have the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we be gentle. How do you know? If I ask you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a rahim, how much do I have that in my heart? How do I know? It is through the compassion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I get it, it will make me lenient, will make me gentle to people. Being gentle, lenient, kind-hearted, tender is a sign that my heart is indeed has received the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a necessary agent of change, as I will speak today to you inshallah in those few minutes. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a gift of compassion. Those who can receive this gift in their heart, then they show it through their acts and their words by being tender, compassionate. Rafiq, rifq. Inna Allah rafiq yuhibbu rifq. Allah is gentle and He loves things in people to be gentle. Inna al-mar la yu'ta ala rifq ma la yu'ta ala ma suwa. One of you will be given. If I want to be given, if I want my family to be given, if I see things that I don't like, perhaps in the masjid, perhaps in my own family, and I want to change it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah will give on kindness, on tenderness, on gentleness, that which you cannot get in any other way. Sometimes, even in our own family circles, we see our kids doing wrong things, and we want to correct them because we're afraid of them. I'm afraid, my son, you're not studying, right? But then our fear gets combined sometimes with anger. Our fear gets combined sometimes with hate. Our fear sometimes gets combined with jealousy. The outcome is not good. But the concept I want to be speaking about today, rahmah, when you have compassion, when you have love, and you add to that compassion and love fear, you have something called shafaqah. What I'm speaking about today in this khutbah is the concept of shafaqah. Shafaqah, what is shafaqah? Shafaqah, huwa hiya al-khawf al-maqroon bi-rahmah. It is actually fear, concern, but when you mix it with compassion and love. Big difference between when I come and I take F's in my exam and my dad tells me, what is this? What? You're a fool, you're stupid, you're not going to go anywhere. His intention is good, he wants to motivate me through what? Through calling me names. That doesn't work. He has fear, right? But sometimes you get angry. After all what I did, I got you private lessons and you're negligent and I'm angry. My fear plus anger leads me to this language. It will not cause change. But if on the other hand, my father, same dad, comes and tells me, Hassan, you took F's. Why, Layabni, why? You should be getting straight A's. What happened? What's wrong? Let me understand. Why? Because you see now what happens to me. He boosted my self-esteem. And he's concerned, he's afraid on me, but he has compassion. His compassion sometimes, when we love our kids, that breeds fear. I see what's going in the society. I have fear, but I have compassion. It leads to a language of shafaqah, to a language of empathy, if you will. I'm empathetic with people around me. That transforms the society. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was a model of this. And I'll share some stories with you about this concept of shafaqah and how it can change things. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with a very simple example. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, إِنِّي لَأَسْمَعْ بُكَاءِ الصَّبِيِّ خَلْفِي. He's praying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, connecting with his Lord. One of the, you know, he's really connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He loves to pray. And he's praying and he hears a young son or daughter crying. What happens? What is the sunnah? If I'm leading salah and in the masjid I hear a kid crying, what should we do? We all know, shorten the prayers, right? So if I do that, I say I followed the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes and no. Yes, you followed the upward sunnah, but why no? Not yet. Why? Because he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us why. فَإِنِّي أَقْصُرُ الصَّلَاةِ شَفَقَةً عَلَى أُمِّهِ أَنْ تُفْتَنْ. And I want you to notice this. I will shorten my prayer. Why? This is the action. Why did you shorten the prayer? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look where he's thinking, look what his heart is. I hear a son crying, I feel for his mother. I understand there is a mother out there praying behind me, and now the salah is going to be a fitna for her. She might leave the salah. See, fear. But this fear with compassion leads me to do what? I will shorten the salah. Can you imagine if you're the mother and you're praying behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and your son was crying, causing havoc in the masjid, in the companions, and you heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying about you, I thought about you, I heard your son crying, I thought about you, that is why I shorted my salah. How would you feel? Would you change? We learn, we change, we respect him so much. Next time, O Prophet of Allah, I'll make sure that my son won't cry, you know, and you feel comfortable. Your self-worth is boosted with this shafaq of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes we follow the outward sunnah, but we don't follow the sunnah of the heart. What do I mean? Is there a sunnah outward and inward? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us this. He told Anas ibn Malik, Ya bunay, in istata'ta an tabit, wa laysa fi qalbak ghishun li ahad faf'al. فإن ذلك من سنتي ومن أحيا سنتي فقد أحبني ومن أحبني فهو معي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He told Anas رضي الله عنه, this young boy teaching him, oh young boy, you know Anas, if you can and before sleep look at your heart, make sure there is no ill feelings to anyone. Why? Because this action of making sure that my heart has no ill feelings towards anyone is a part of my sunnah. There is a sunnah that has to do with the heart. That's a sunnah. And whoever yani brings life to my sunnah, resurrects my sunnah, he loves me. And whoever loves me is with me in Jannah. So today, I want to speak more about this concept of compassion that leads to empathy. Understanding, feeling people. Feeling, understanding. When I hear a child crying, I can feel, I can sense the mother and how she's feeling. Right? And I'm able to reflect that back to her. That can cause tremendous change. He sallallahu, and wallahi, we need this individually in our families, in our society. In our families, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a beautiful example of him with this shafaqah and empathy that he has. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sitting with Abu Bakr and Umar. You have guests at your house. Just want you to imagine this. Sitting, and he's honorable, he's respectable, he's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all of a sudden, a dish comes. One of his wives yani cooked something and brought it to him, you know. So as the dish comes in, Aisha radiallahu anha, his wife, his beloved love, she felt so upset. So she came out in front of the guests and she hits the dish. And she spills the dish. And the dish falls and breaks and the food is all over the place. I ask you, if that is my or your wife, you're sitting with guests, a dish comes and your wife comes out in front of them and hits the dish in the air and the dish falls, and what's my reaction? I feel angry, legitimately, right? This is unacceptable, right? I feel upset, I feel angry, how dare you, right? And then I start criticizing and things will spiral down, right? But look at him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and look at his response. His response was amazing. He is amazing, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is truly a heart of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His response was very simple. He went down to the food on the ground. He did not, and he started collecting the food together, and he says one word. You know what it is? He starts saying, "Gharat ummukuma, gharat ummukuma, gharat ummukuma." And it's amazing what is he addressing? He says the following. Your mother felt jealous. Your mother felt jealous. Your mother felt jealous. What is he speaking about? Look at his concern. He noticed that Abu Bakr and Umar are sitting there. Aisha entering and throwing the dish in the air, how will they feel? Maybe perhaps Abu Bakr, her father, will be more upset, right? So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he understands, why did she do this? See, it's not about me, it's not about, I have the legitimate reasons to be angry, yes. But he puts that on the side. And why did she do that? Ah, she's jealous, isn't she? That's what it's about. So he reflects this feeling to her. I understand what you're feeling. You're jealous. But at the same time, he's reminding his companions that Aisha radiallahu anha is Umm al-Mu'mineen. The wives of the prophets are the mothers of the believers. So he's telling them what? It's your mother that got jealous. It's your mother. So calm down. And then later, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he goes and he addresses this with Aisha. Later, yes, I understand you are jealous, but Aisha, that was not right. And then when you do that, and when you reflect that feeling, and she understands, see, he sees me. Oh, Prophet of Allah, what should I do? I know I will see. Now she's open. Oh, Aisha, make another dish of food and send it back to the other woman. We change people When we have this level of empathy and compassion, when we understand what it's about, in many cases, in households especially, many of the arguments, marital, is about this, the inability that it's about a feeling. The wife is just jealous. And sometimes, instead of arguments, which are legitimate, all what you have to do is what? Please try this. Whenever you get into an argument with someone that, you know, has an opposing view at your house, with your spouse, with your kids, try doing the following. Pause and reflect to the person what he wants to say. I see that, stop, and just summarize. I see where you're coming from. And try to understand what you're saying is this. I hear you saying this. And reflect the feeling. And then the other person, once he knows that you understand, he'll calm down and he'll be open to change. He, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, did not get angry for himself. Rather, this method of showing empathy and shafaqah change and transform people. There is a hadith narrated by Ibn Umar. And this is a narration that, like, it's very interesting. That he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was so generous. He never had money, you know, in his hands. And one time it happened that he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, had 10 dirhams. You know, for some brief time. So he went out and he wanted to buy a new shirt. So he goes, he buys a new shirt. He goes out. A man from the Ansar sees the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And something is different about him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He has a new shirt. And that man of the Ansar comes to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and notice what he tells him. Subhanaka Rabb. You know when you want to entice someone to do something for you? You know, son, do this and I'll get you an Xbox, right? That man of the Ansar said something. Ya Rasulullah, iksini thawban kasaakallahu iya, kasaakallahu thawban min thiyab al-jannah. Oh, Prophet of Allah, give me a shirt that Allah gave to you. May Allah give you a shirt from the shirts of Jannah. See, like, how can you imagine a wife telling her husband, dear, please bring me a new car. May Allah give you a car from the cars of Jannah. But how do we entice each other? Look at the difference, right? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, hearing this dua, do you understand? He couldn't, how can you say no, right? This is a dua. Like, so immediately he goes, takes off the new shirt, wears the old one, goes to the man, gives him, right, like the shirt. And he goes back, gets a new one. So he spends 8 dirhams. As he's walking, it says, in the hadith, he notices a young girl crying. And this is again the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You can continue, but he feels a girl is crying. How is she feeling? Something is wrong. He feels her pain. A young girl. So he goes, so, Mayu Kiki, why are you crying, young girl? You know, what's wrong? Why are you, and this is a, can you imagine? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming to, I don't know, 11, 10, 9, 7 years old, telling her to calm down. Why are you crying? What's wrong? Can I help you? I feel it, right? So she says, and she recognizes who he is. Oh, Prophet of Allah, my family gave me 2 dirhams and they asked me to go to the marketplace to buy certain, you know, things, and I lost them. I'm afraid now if I go back, they might be angry and upset at me. So what does he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he feels it. So he says, don't worry, I have 2 dirhams. Here, take those 2 dirhams, right? He gives her the 2 dirhams, go buy your things, you know, don't cry anymore. And as he attempts to leave, she starts crying again. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, turns back. Now, why are you crying? What happened? I mean, the problem is, obviously, no. And you can tell again their state. Now it's going to be worse, because if I go and tell my parents I lost the 2 dirhams and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave me his 2 dirhams, it's going to be double trouble, right? So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and look at this shafaqah. He says, would you love that I walk with you back home and talk to your parents regarding this matter? And the girl is amazed. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is going to walk me home and speak on behalf of me? Yes, O Prophet of Allah. So he goes to her house and he knocks the door, as the narration says. He knocks the door, Assalamu alaikum. Silence. He knocks the door again, Assalamu alaikum. Silence. He knocks the third time, Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Silence. And you know the ruling, you knock 3 times, nobody responds. He's about to leave. As he's turning, the door opens. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh, O Prophet of Allah. And the first thing he says, what happened? I knocked 3 times. Why the lady? You didn't answer. He said, oh, Prophet of Allah, we knew. We heard your voice. We knew who it was. And we want what أَفَأَرَضْنَا أَن نَسْتَزِيد مِنِ السَّلَامِ. I don't know if you get. What did he say when you knock, when we greet each other? What do we say? السلام عليكم. You know that, that's a dua. السلام عليكم. It's not only peace be upon you. Salam from Salim. You know when you say قلب سليم, قلب that is free from defects. So salam is may you be free from all defects and may you have peace. You know, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying what? Assalamu alaikum. They loved. He's making dua for us. So shh, let him say it again. Salam alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Oh, the Prophet is making dua for me again and again. And then they said, oh Prophet of Allah, what an honor, what brought you here? He said, هذه الجارية أشفقت على هذه الجارية أن تضربوها. I came here out of شفقة. This compassion with fear. This girl, I have compassion and I'm afraid that she did something. I came here with her so that you don't hurt her in any way. Don't harm her. Yes, she lost 2 dirhams. But please. And you know what happened? Notice the change in people. When they see this, oh, that's why you came here? And they said, Ya Rasulullah, هي حرة لوجه الله ولمن شاك معها. We make you witness, she was a slave girl. She is free for the sake of Allah, and because she was the reason that made you come to us, she is free for the sake of Allah. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, indeed Allah has blessed those 10 dirhams that he gave to me. He gave his Prophet a shirt. He gave a man from the Ansar a shirt and he freed a young woman. Shafaqa, brothers and sisters, can transform societies. One more example, Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a, one of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because sometimes, yani, we make mistakes. And Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a was a great companion that witnessed the Battle of Badr. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, towards the end of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after Sulh Hudaybiyah and what happened, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants now to go to open Mecca, Fath Mecca. And him being the compassionate person he is, he does not want the people to know that he's coming so they don't fight. So that no casualties. Right? So he tried to keep it a secret. Don't tell them. Let's surprise them. They don't fight. We take Mecca. Things are peaceful. But something happens. Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a sends a letter to Abu Sufyan. من حاطب ابن أبي بلتاعي إلى أبو سفيان, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is heading your way, so take heed, be prepared. Jibreel comes and informs Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he tells people to intercept the message, they bring it back, and he has the message. And I want you to imagine this, him صلى الله عليه وسلم sitting in the masjid, the companions around, حاطب ابن أبي بلتاعة here, and here is the message. And he صلى الله عليه وسلم tells them, read it in front of everyone. And they open the message and they read it. من حاطب ابن أبي بلتاعة to Abu Sufyan. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is coming your way. Take heed. So he looks to حاطب ابن أبي بلتاعة. And wallahi, brothers and sisters, have you ever been betrayed? You know how it feels when you do good to someone and he stabs you in the back? How do you feel? Is this what I deserve? You can be very critical to that person, and legitimately so. That's wrong. That's treason. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks to Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a in front of everyone and says, Ya Hatib, ma hadha? Hatib, what is this? What's this? And Umar ibn al-Khattab, you know, of course, getting upset for the legitimate, Ya Rasulullah, da'ani adrib unaqa, oh Prophet of Allah, let me get rid of him. He's a hypocrite. This is treason. This deserves the capital punishment. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is the point I want here. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no, wait, Umar. And he looks to Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a. Please understand this. Look what he's going to do. He says, Ya Hatib, ma dafa'aka li hadha? Oh Hatib, what made you do this? What do you see here? I want to understand. You're a believer. That's wrong. There's something. I want to understand. Why did you do this? What happened? What caused you to do this? Let me understand. Let me hear. And Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a, seeing this, see how people react. Saying, oh Prophet of Allah, I'm not a hypocrite. By Allah, I know that you're his Prophet. I know that Allah is going to grant you fatha, to open Mecca. I know, no doubt. However, I had family members in Mecca. And I had no tribes to defend them. I don't have any lineage or tribal, you know, membership to defend them. I was afraid that if we go, Abu Sufyan might harm my family members. So I wanted to write something to Abu Sufyan. I know it's not going to do anything. But then, when we approach, he remembered this, so he won't harm my family. What do you see here? Why did Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a do this? Can you feel him? It's not that he's a traitor. It is not that he wants to destroy Islam. He's a father that loved his kids, loved his wife, and he weakened because of this. And because of this weakness, he did something wrong. Do you feel, are you empathetic to him? So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks to Umar ibn al-Khattab, understanding this, telling him, Ya Umar, leave Hatib ibn Abi Baltaha alone. Because he was one that witnessed the battle of Badr. See, he did good before. And perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked to those people that witnessed the battle of Badr and told them, go do whatever you want, I forgave you. And Umar ibn al-Khattab himself breaks into tears. And you can tell why. When you see this, it changes people, brothers and sisters. This attitude, what do you think Khatib ibn Abi Baltaha would be like? Aisha radiallahu anha, after what she did, how do you think she's like? When we give people this compassion that has tenderness, gentleness, empathy in it, we change. They can change. I'll tell you this before we end this first part of the khutbah. In psychotherapy, you know, sometimes people have troubles, mental health issues. Sometimes it's depression, sometimes it's anxiety, sometimes marital issues, sometimes trauma, PTSD, sometimes there are many issues. So people do psychotherapy, you go for therapy, and there is more, so many counseling theories, you know, behaviorism, cognitive therapy, existential therapy, there is so many models and interventions. So in a study, they wanted to see what affects the outcome of therapy. You know, in cases that, you know, people went into therapy and it was successful, what was the number one cause of, you know, the success of the therapy? And you would imagine is the theory used. Perhaps one of the counseling theory, the techniques, the methods, you know. I mean, you learn, you go, you have a PhD in the topic, you know what to do. A person is traumatized. What kind of intervention, EMDR or CBT, or like, you know, there are many, many of those counseling theories. And the research came back a number of times, and this is in the literature, shocking. The research says the following, the number one contributor, why therapy succeeds, why people actually change, has nothing to do with the counseling theory used. This is the least of the factors. The number one factor was what? Therapeutic alliance. That what does that mean? That the relationship between the therapist and the person seeking therapy, he feels that he's listened to. He feels the empathy of the therapist. He feels this relationship, if it is good, and he feels he's listened to, and somebody else is understanding, just that by itself accounts for more than 50 to 60% of why therapy succeeds. Subhanallah. And by the way, here's a reflection for you. The word rahm, compassion. Of the roots of it, rahim, womb. The womb of a mother. What does a womb represent? It's the place where a child is nourished. It's a place where a child is developed. It's a place where a child is protected. Rahma, compassion, when dispensed with gentleness, tenderness, with shafaqah, it nourishes people. They will change. They have it in them. They have the answers in them. We have the answers of our problems in us. We have the seeds of goodness in us. If they're nurtured, they flower. All what we need is to nurture those seeds. How? Compassion, tenderness, rifq, gentleness, rahmah. And a person and the society transforms. قول قولي هذا واستغفر الله. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أفضل المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. وبعد we can speak about شفقة and the stories of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم for so long. سبحانك يا رب. But I want to just end with certain pointers, if you will, certain practical things. What to do? If I want this tenderness, if I want this gentleness, if I want to extract this from my heart, and some of the benefits of that. So I'll share some things with you. First, there is another side, a side benefit to the concept of shafaqah, compassion, the ability to feel others, the ability to understand how they feel. And let me give it to you scientifically first before practically. And this is wallahi some of the wisdoms of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Psychologists, they did an experiment. Monkeys, and they gave them nuts. Monkeys like nuts. They started eating, and specific neurons of pleasure started firing. You know, their measuring was, so the monkey is eating nuts and he's so happy, he's so elated. So a specific neuron pattern in the brain is firing, right? Which indicates pleasure and happiness, and he's really happy. Alhamdulillah, good. Then they did something really interesting. They got a monkey, gave him nuts, got another monkey and made him watch. So he's watching another monkey eating nuts. And they measured the brain response of the monkey who's just watching. He's not eating anything. And they found the same neurons that are firing in the monkey's head who's eating is firing in the second monkey who's watching. And they call this mirror neurons. You know what does that mean? He is feeling the same pleasure as the first one, although he's not eating the nuts. I don't know if you understand what that means. What that means is a very simple thing. Sometimes to feel happy, I need to eat, right? I need to drink. Well, maybe not. If I watch someone that maybe perhaps I love drinking and he's quenching his thirst, guess what happens? I feel the same pleasure like him. It's happened. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, if you wanted from the seer of this example, when they were immigrating, right? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was thirsty and Abu Bakr got him, yeah, radiallahu anhu, got him milk. And he gave it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, drink, O Prophet of Allah, you're thirsty. He says the following, فَشَرِبَ حَتَّى ارْتَوَيْتَ. He says something and he says, so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drank till I quenched my own thirst. What am I speaking about? The ability to relate to others, the ability to have empathy, to feel, might make my life an enjoyable life. All what, and this is the first training exercise, how to be empathetic, how to be, have compassion to be. Watch people that are happy and feel it. Watch kids play. Have you ever watched kids play? No, I'm on my smartphone. If you have kids, watch them. Do you feel how happy they are? You will feel their happiness. They will be doing the work. You will be feeling the happiness. Watch someone who's happy because he succeeded. If I feel how happy he is, guess what? I don't need to have what he has. This is the antidote of envy. I don't need to have what you have to be happy. All what I have to do is what? Feel your happiness. So be happy with what you have. If I feel it, guess what? I'm as happy as you, even if I don't have it. SubhanAllah. So the first training exercise is what? I want you to try to be happy for the happiness of others. Kids is an excellent example. Two, when you, let's say I'm making wudu, this is for gentleness. How do you open the water? You know, we open it all the way. No. Try to be gentle. Open it, let it drip. First, you're conserving water, but the second is the concept of tenderness. Be tender even in the way you make wudu. That breeds in me gentleness. So, having shafaq, having compassion, having this ability to be empathetic to others, not only transforms other people, because wallahi, it is the soil that makes the seeds grow, but it transforms me. It allows me to, your happiness becomes my happiness. Right? Your feelings, I understand it, I can listen to it, and therefore I can react accordingly. And that can be a transformative, transformative to my relation, to my kids, to my wife, to my husband, to my community. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill our hearts with His compassion and His rahmah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to be empathetic to all the creation. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the Muslims in this country and everywhere. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to veil the shortcomings of Muslims in this country and everywhere. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the light of prophethood and the light of the Quran from the shortcomings of those who represent it. Ameen ya Rabb. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين اللهم رد أمة محمد إلى التحقق بلا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأقم الصلاة